So I've not been with you for the last couple of weeks, so it's great to be back with you. It's great to be serving into this morning, and I pray that the Spirit will continue to move. We're going to be looking at Luke 4. We spent some time looking at this verse in Isaiah, but Luke 4, 16 to 21 later. Now, we would all say that we live in a broken world. Now, how would we define what a broken world is? It's easy for us this morning to think of the macro brokenness. So we have a world full of corruption. Unfortunately, we have economic equality. The youth are going out this morning, apparently. So if you're part of the youth, then your time is now to depart. I won't take it personally, don't worry. Okay, so wars, corruption, economic equality, all would form part of our broken world. We're all aware of the word terrorism.
The world is full of brokenness and famine. These are all what I would consider the macro brokenness. These are things that are larger than maybe chapter 100. These are the wider economic brokenness. However, there are many things very close to home that we live in a broken world. Broken families. We work with several in through our WIFI program. We have families with no shelter or homes, no means to support themselves, whether this be clothing, stability. We have these pointing to a broken world. I want to pause there. I want to read the scripture, and then we're going to pray. So Luke chapter 4, 16 to 21. I have a section of it on the screen. I'll read it in full. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And it was his custom. He went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. And the scroll of the prophet of Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty for the captives, and the recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the life of the Lord's favor." And he rolled the scroll up and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of the synagogue were upon him. And he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." So he found the verse in Isaiah. We spent 11 weeks going through that scripture in detail. So I'm not going to unpack it verse by verse. But we see here that the Lord is here for the poor. Not just the physically poor, but the spiritually poor. Those who live in brokenness. So we can agree that we live in brokenness, and no matter what we do, we can't always get out. But we know that wasn't part of God's plan. God's plan was perfect, like he was. God's plan for us was different than the world of brokenness. The Bible calls that sin. That sin moved us from God's plan into the world of brokenness. So as a church, how do we respond to this brokenness? How do we sit here gathered today, I'd say in an air-conditioned room, but not quite, building with chairs? How do we respond as a church to the brokenness that we are living in? We've seen it in the Bible. How do we respond? Well, we could choose to have an attitude of us and them. We could say, well, we're not in brokenness because we've been restored back to God's plan through Jesus Christ, which is amazing. We could choose to have an us and them, that they are broken and we are not. We could live in our bubble with our jobs. We could choose not to support those in need. We could choose to not pray for those
in need. We can choose to carry on with our lives day to day, week by week, going to work, paying the bills, raising the children, going to work, paying the bills. We could choose career, we could choose to continue that corporate ladder, we could choose the best schools, to live in the best neighbourhoods, because they're not trouble. We could choose all of these things. How would that allow us as Christians to deliver the light to the world, to the brokenness? Or we can choose differently. We could choose to engage in that brokenness, accept, understand, acknowledge that the brokenness exists. We can choose to support. We can choose to help. We can choose that God, I acknowledge that God sent us to be lights, sent us to be beacons in the darkness. But He has placed us here. Some have grown up here, some have been sent here. God has placed us here to minister to the brokenness of our area. Now we can support on a macro level, we can support those wider organisations. But we can also support those locally here in Chatford and the surrounding areas. So we can acknowledge that God has sent us back into the world of brokenness to be His light. And as a church, we can be His hands and feet with the Spirit into that brokenness. So we can choose to support. We can choose to pray. The giving that you give weekly, monthly, and a portion of that we give to different churches and different ministries. So we also, the money that the church receives, give that back out into the communities. And then on top, we give out to our 180 program that I'll talk about in a second. We can choose to open up our lives, to not be this living in this bubble, to not be living in this protected area, but we can open our lives. We can get messy, we can get dirty. We can open up our homes. So I know that you'll have seen on the news that we're asking people to open their homes for Ukraine refugees. We can open our homes. We can buy food for those that have less. And we can choose to volunteer in those programs that are offering support for the micro and the micro areas. So we want to be part of a church that actively engages in these activities. For us, are we an attractional church or are we a missional church? Are we trying to gather or are we trying to be on mission in wider areas? So how do we respond? We want to be an expanding church that doesn't just form the boundaries of a Sunday morning gathering. It's great to join, it's great to pray, it's great to be with you all. But here today, this morning, we're not reaching the lost. Today, this morning, we're being built up that tomorrow, this afternoon, this week, we can then help support the brokenness. So it's lovely to gather. I love seeing your faces. I love being with you. But actually, I want us all to be on mission. I want us to be built up that we are on a mission together. That we are committed to seeing lives changed. Committed to seeing those built up around us. Committed to seeing those transformed from darkness into light. Committed to seeing the name of Jesus shine through everyone here. Because it's through Jesus, and Jesus alone, that we can be restored back to God's plan. It's from that brokenness, trying to escape, that acknowledging Jesus died on the cross, rose again 3 years later, defined Him as the crown, as the King of our lives, can we then be restored into His plan. And this is the prayer that I have for us today. So we see in Isaiah 58, 6 to 9, that God cares for the needy.
It wasn't 3 years later, it was 3 days later.
Did I say 3 years?
Yeah.
Jesus rose again 3 days later. Oh dear, that was a Freudian slip, wasn't it? 3 days later, I'm pretty sure it was 3 days later. So Isaiah 58, 6 to 9, it reads, "It is not the fast... It is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the straps of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, and bring the homelessness poor into your homes? When you see the naked, to cover, and not to hide yourself from your own flesh? Then shall your light break forth like dawn, and let your healing shall spring up speedily. Your righteousness shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry, and he will say, 'Here I am.' Take away the yoke from your midst, and the pointing of the finger, and speaking wickedness." That's from the ESV. "And I will be your rear guard. Whatever we do, wherever we go, the Lord is our rear guard. He will not let us fall. He will not let us stumble." I'm going to pause and talk about the 180 program for a second. So as a church, we have a community action arm that you are all supporting by your tithes and offerings. Elle leads up that team with several others working in the team. So Elle's just given me a short update as to the different things that we're doing as a community. Some of you may know, some may be less familiar. Just want to pause and have a share about that. So the schools program for this year is slowly coming to an end as the children break up for school. So they've just had their May celebration. They go through 10 weeks of activities, teachings, and they've just had their celebration. The school heads have given a great response to those, saying how impactful they can see with children's lives turned around through these programs. So for those that are involved in MAID, thank you. I know there's a few of you here, so really well done. And the schools have just signed for next year as well. So the MAID program is expanding here in Chafford, and it's just great to have that. The Kintsugi Wellness and Wellbeing Program is happening in Ockenden, and that's just been going through a great period this last year. Again, the schools have signed up for that next year, so we have 1 day a week in South Ockenden, which is just fantastic. And also we have mentoring here in Chafford 100 as well for those secondary school students. 180 Families remains very busy, with Lydia taking the lead on this, spending a lot of time working with the families of need. So this is whether this be basics on food, whether this be going to the food bank, clothing, with the rise of inflation, with the cost of living. So these families are really struggling. So Lydia's been doing a fantastic job there. Piglets, my children went to Piglets, so the young parents and children's group here in Chafford and also in Chadwell. That's going really well. And many, many families have joined, and we've given away 43 welcome packs, which is just fantastic. And every pack has a kind of a binder. And in that binder, every week, they put a Bible story in there. So they read a Bible story as these parents who are not Christians. They read the Bible story, and then they take that card and they put it in their binder. And even those parents that are missing a week, they come back and say, "Can I have last week's Bible reading, because I don't want to miss it." And this is impactful, because then from Piglets, we've had our different events. So the holiday events, we had a Jubilee event, and two mums who came to the Jubilee event gave their lives to Christ. So from just having relationships of mum and babies and fathers and children in these groups, to then being part of the family holiday groups, giving their life to Christ. It's just amazing, these programs. It's not just having coffee and biscuits and playing with the children. This is impacting people's lives. So we also saw a uniform pop-up shop. I don't know if some of you donated to that or saw it, but around 30 families came, and they, for those that can't afford school uniforms, they're reusing school uniforms, so thank you to those that donated. We have bags of uniforms to sort. So in August, if anybody wants to help, contact Elle. She'll be working with organising all of that. And then there's one mentioned about the Ukraine refugees and the asylum seekers. So we have joined and we're part of a multinational group, multi-town group in the area to support those in need. And we're also setting up connect cafes for those Ukraine families that want to gather together at this time of need, whether they have similar situations, they can reach out and they can have coffee. And then we're also starting a Welcome to Britain course. So this may seem strange for some of us. Why do you need a course on Welcome to Britain? Well, in some cultures, people don't queue. So this is teaching people some of the basics on how to queue. What is socially etiquette in the area? How do you approach different scenarios to help them integrate and not feel isolated? So we may laugh and smile around queuing, but it's really important that we're able to help people's lives. So everybody who's part of the MAID 180, the Piglets, different families, I'm not going to name them all again, but thank you for what you're doing. It's impacting in the community. If you want to be part of it, please contact Elle. It should be great to have more volunteers. So that's how we can continue to work in the community. On to this, how are we going to be the church for a broken world? It's not the macro level, it's at the individual level. How are you going to be Christ's helper in a world of brokenness? How are you, wherever you are, going to be able to reach the lost? I can reach people that you can't, and you can reach people that I can't. God has sent you into your job, your situation, your family scenario, and wherever your feet are going, the Spirit will go before you and you can shine God's light. So I think we need to respond to this morning. And then we also need to continue to be on the lookout for physical needs, but also spiritual needs. That people are physically needing our support, but also spiritually. Those that are lost need our prayers. Those that are lost need our support. And you'll have recognized these three circles. It's shared a couple of weeks ago during our Everyone a Witness. It's an opportunity, it's a framework, it's a model that allows you to share God's story and to bring people to Christ. It's very helpful. However, be prepared. Things can get messy. Things can get messy. Now, messy, I don't mean catastrophic. This is, if you're opening your homes, if you're opening your life, if you're opening your heart for the lost, things may not always go as the plan that you want them. But it's the obedience of Christ in sharing that love that we need to be obedient to. That it may mean extra hours. It may mean changing our schedules. It may mean we can help with people being picked up to come to life groups, to come to different things. It's going to be out of the norm. So be prepared for things to get messy. With the three circles, I have, and some of those in my life group, I have a Monday-Thursday plan. Now you're thinking, what is a Monday-Thursday plan? That's a crazy thing. My Monday-Thursday plan is as follows. On a Monday, it's the day after Sunday. Thursday is the day after Wednesday. We have church here on a Sunday, and we have life group, my life groups on a Wednesday. So my Monday-Thursday plan is I speak to the first five people that I see on a Monday and the first five people that I see on a Thursday about what we've done here today and what we did on life group, whether that's we talked about this. This was the prayer verse. This is what we were singing. I was preaching yesterday, by the way, on this topic. And it allows me very openly at church. Because people ask me, how was your weekend? Oh, I'm pleased you asked. Because yesterday I was preaching on this topic. Oh, what did you do last night? Did you see the Bible? No, I didn't. I was at life group, but we talked about this. People are actually asking you what you did last night. How was your weekend? How do you respond at the coffee machine? Yeah, it was fine. Really? It was fine? We had an amazing spiritual encounter. We baptized some people. Yeah, it was fine. So how do you respond to those questions? Now, when I said things get messy, it was messy for you once. It was messy for me once. I wasn't always saved. There was a time in my life when there was darkness. There was a time in my life when things weren't as they should be. But through Jesus Christ dying and rising again 3 days later, now my life has purpose. My life has direction. So think of those things when your life wasn't what it's now, like now. People are in that same situation. People are in darkness. People are lost. So if you're on this side, think about what happened beforehand. This is the 15-minute testimony, 15-second testimony. It depends on how quickly you can work through it. But there are six words, six sentences. I used to be lost. Jesus transformed my life. This is where I am now. Do you have a story like this? It's a way of sharing the gospel. So how are we? How are you being a church for the broken world? What are we going to do differently? What are we going to do differently to be that church for the broken world? Now, we're on mission. We have a very clear mandate as a church to see lives transformed, for people to be added to our services weekly, our congregations weekly, to have a wide and impactful influence in our communities. Are we living that vision? Are we living that mission? Are we a church for the broken world? Now, if you're not a Christian this morning, don't leave this place without speaking to somebody about how your life can be transformed through Jesus Christ. If you are a believer, and many faces I recognize are in that place, what are you going to do differently this week? How is this going to challenge you, stirring you, pushing you forward to be a church in a broken world? We can choose to ignore it. We can choose to ignore what's happening. We can say, I'm helpless in a worldwide corruption engine. Or we can look close and say, how can I have a wide and effective influence in my community? That family that I see every day next door but one, struggling, how am I going to be shining God's light through me to that family and offer to pray? I tell you, many people will say, sorry, it's just not for me. They'll apologize to you for you interrupting their dinner. Don't worry, you're not going to get punched in the face. Don't worry, they're not going to think less of you. We've been through. But people will apologize to you. Sorry, it's not for me. And then you can continue to pray. But it's the obedience of being there. It's the obedience of that love. So I want us to take some time to pray. I want us to, wherever we are, in small 5, 6, 7s, just pray for a few minutes together about what we've heard, read this morning. And how are we going to be a church for a broken world? We'll come back and I'll finish shortly. For those online, please just bear with us and pray wherever you are for the church to be a broken world. and we'll come back with you in a few minutes. So just where you are, guys, let's just gather together this effective influence in a broken world. Thank you. Yeah, Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the light in our lives. Lord, thank you that you have transformed us, that you have turned our lives around, that we may be restored to you, Heavenly Father. Lord, I pray that you will raise us up, as Carlton prayed, soldiers, raise an army for you. That we will be prepared. We will be ready to go into the world. Lord, use the light that is in us to shine through to others, Lord. Send us where we are day to day, in our workplace, in our homes, in our neighborhoods. Lord, that we will be ready. We will have a heart for the broken. Lord, transform our lives that we yearn to help those that are broken, that live in darkness, that don't know Jesus in their lives. Lord, if we have a heart, then our lives will follow. Lord, work in us, transform us, as we are saved, that we may share that love with others. Lord, and be prepared to send us. Be prepared for us to go, to support, to work with, to volunteer, both on the macro level and also closer to home. So I pray that hearts are transformed this morning into the vision that we are a church for the broken world. I pray this in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen.